Good morning, everyone. We are from Team Analytics and we are working on Sunbird Analytics. Here is my team. I am Siddharth, Alexa, Shivam, and Tanmay. So starting off with our objective, our first objective was to install Sunbird portal on our local machine, followed by playing around with the code, getting our hands dirty and understand each of the controllers, views, workflow between them, and then use various Sunbird APIs in order to generate analytic reports. And in case we don't have such APIs, then create our own data APIs based on our requirements, install Sunbird server on our local machine and testing our own created APIs on the server. So let me give an overview of what we have done. We have successfully installed Sunbird portal on our local machine. We faced some challenges in the beginning, but they were easily fixable. They were just the problem with the version of Node and the dependencies. And we went through the entire scripts. What was nightmare for us was there was no comments in there. So we had to figure out everything on our own, how each of the component worked. And especially ma'am helped us a lot in this phase. And we successfully added an analytics section which generates four different kind of reports in there. First one is content consumption, followed by location-wise course enrollment, gender and education-wise course enrollment. And we tried installing Sunbird server for more than 26 times, failed every time except one. Sent over 100 emails to Team Sunbird and XTEP without getting any proper reply. We didn't get the required API key in order to test their API. So as suggested by Team Sunbird, we created our own APIs in order to test the front end. And in the end, our only working server stopped working. So we had to map everything from Cassandra to MySQL because we had a software which generates random data for us. So rather than again entering data into Cassandra, we had a software to do that for us. And now I'll ask my friend to tell about the technologies we have used.
Yeah, coming to the technologies part, the technologies we use in our project are the Cassandra, AngularJS, Node.js, cluster module in Node.js, and ExpressJS. The Cassandra, the database used in the Sunbird is the Cassandra, and this Cassandra driver is used to access the database. Coming to the AngularJS, we used AngularJS to create a reports tab that is in the front end part. Node.js, and the Node.js we use it to create the data APIs. Cluster module in Node.js, the cluster module in Node.js we use it to increase the throughput of the system. ExpressJS is a library which we created a server to get the request. Over to my friend Shivam to continue the session.
So this was the part that took we did this part over 26 times and just succeeded once. So it's the Sunbird server installation. So initially we generated the XTEP API key from the JWT.io website, then installed and updated the Git and cloned the Sunbird DevOps folder, and then we updated the config file based upon the information provided on the documentation of Sunbird server installation. This step includes 8 different stages of installation. The first was the sanity check. It just checks the prerequisites if they are prerequisite softwares if they are properly installed or not, and it also checks the RAM if it's compatible. The second was the config, it installs the config and the host files. The third is deps, it installs all the dependencies. DBS installs and configures the Cassandra database. APIs was used to install and deploy the Kong API. Proxy was used for installing NGX server. So this step used to install KeyClock, which is used for authentication purpose, and this eight stage core. So all the other stages were third party, of the third party, but this was of Sunbird, and Sunbird software. So we have developed some error guide, and IIT Bombay X team also helped us in this. So the first error was that SSH connection failed. So we'll have to develop the SSH connection. The RAM not enough. So initially we took a local system which had 4 GB RAM, but we didn't check at the initial step that what was the RAM, and then we faced this error. So actually the RAM should be of 8 GB. Second was the refused to connect data. So the database was refused to connect. So here we had to add a host in the /etc/host files. The third was this error was coming at the API stage. So what we advise that it should be done before that API stage. So here we had to change the pg_hba.config file and do the necessary as described here and in the report. And the final was that IP address was unreachable. So here we added host name and the IP address to the ansible/host files. So this was the steps we did, and only once we had succeeded to successfully install the Sunbird server, but then eventually at the end that also stopped.
Good morning guys, I will be explaining about the front end. So this is just a flow chart for the workflow and when the APIs are called. So I'll be explaining through this video. So we have made this video. So first you log in. So let me point out here that initially there were only as you can see there are 6 tabs right now. Initially there were only 5. The analytics tab, the last one, is what we have added. So we had to go through a lot of code. As Siddharth said earlier, it was very painful, and as he already said that we had added 4 tabs: content consumption, education wise, and location and gender. So let's start with the content consumption. As you can see, there are 3 drop downs here. So the first drop down is for this all the courses that the user has created. So the user who is interested in seeing the analytics will choose the course for which he wants to view the analytics. And as soon as he selects a course, the list of courses is fetched to a API that we have written. It is called the Get Courses API. So once you select a course, another API is used to fetch all the contents within the course. So the second drop down is for that. So all the contents are fetched. As soon as you select the content for which you want to see the graphs, and you can see the graph, there are 2 things. There's a graph and there's also a table we have provided here. And you can change, the third drop down is for choosing the graph type. You can, for content consumption, we have line graph and area graph and one more, I can't remember it. So so this was content consumption. The rest of the 3 are very similar to each other, and so I will be explaining only one. So this is the area wise distribution. So here we have only 2 drop downs. So the first one is again for the selecting the courses. Again it is fetched through Get Courses API, and again we can select the graph type. So I like to add that we have used this Google Charts for doing all these graphs and these things. because I really like Google Charts, all the width adjustments and all, it can be done very easily using Google Charts. And also they provide very beautiful charts. So yeah, changing the graph type is also very easy. So yeah. So that was the front end part. So this is the education, and after that, finally we have the gender one. So over to Siddharth, he will explain about the data APIs.
These are the screenshots of various reports which are being generated. And then coming to the backend, which is working behind all this. So first of all, let me give you a little overview of how it works. So basically, I have created an Express-based Node.js server, which accepts all those requests. All the API calls are post, which takes the user ID. And when we log in into Sunbird, what we get after handshake is a session token. So this should also be sent in the header along with the ID, course ID, and the X session token or X user authentication which we get. So generally it should be a very easy task, but the problem with Cassandra is it doesn't provide any joins, any group bys, or any kind of aggregation. So we have to do everything programmatically. And the Node.js is asynchronous programming. So before even we can fetch the data, it was pre-processing it, and we were getting a null response. So how we managed to do this synchronous programming in an asynchronous environment was something using callbacks. So it's function under a function under a function. It goes till D level till we get the required response, and in the end we send the response to the server. And first API is get course gender distribution. It basically, based on the course ID, it checks the course enrollment, gets the user ID of each of them, use that user ID to determine the gender, and in the end performs the aggregation and returns an array of JSON objects in which there is a gender type and the count of the number of course enrollment belonging to that category. And it is same for education area. The content consumption is a little different because we had to convert the timestamp and all. So the in content consumption, each content has an ID followed by user ID and the timestamp when it was consumed. So we had to convert that timestamp into required format, and it performs aggregation over a period of a year. So it shows the consumption pattern in the last year, how it's basically number of times that content was viewed in that year. So it's a simple query. We just give the timestamp along with the content ID, and it gets all the number of times it was being viewed. And then the response is a JSON object, array of JSON object with month and year. And one thing I would like to, as in the beginning you said that we don't even know how to use each course of our machine. So we finally figured out how to use that. So basically there's a module in Node.js called cluster. Node.js was designed to use only one core of your PC. So what this cluster does is, it copies the program and it runs on each server. So it increases your throughput, it does the load balancing, and it increases the stability. So even if one worker goes down, other are still responsive. And what I have written is, if one, by any chance, if one crashes, one worker crashes, then it creates a new fork. Like it forks a new one. And so it basically increases the throughput and the stability. So that's all. So any queries?
So when you wrote the API, yeah, did you have a sample API to look at?
Yes, sir.
You had. And that was useful?
Yeah, sir.
How long did it take you to write the complete API, test it, and confirm that it is working?
Lot of time, sir, as I said.
The second point is, when you are writing an API, why did you not make it more generic by saying that the user can actually request a time interval during which the user wants the data. You are fixing it to 1 year.
Yes, sir.
It is not always that I would like a 1 year long history or something.
Yes, sir, that's something which can be fixed.
Because that is rather easy to fix.
Yeah, yeah.
And that would make your API more generic.
Sure, sir, we'll do it.
Okay. Was this your first time handling Cassandra and such things?
Yes, sir.
Yes. So you learned something useful?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
I never used Angular and Node 2, sir.
You did not use Angular also?
Yes, sir.
Even the Node.js was used earlier?
Yes, sir. It was a new thing. And it took us a lot of time to figure out how to do this synchronously, because even before our...
The key for future is such new things will keep emerging. These were not there 10 years ago. These will be replaced by something else 10 years ago, 10 years later. What it means is in each of your professional career, be prepared to keep learning new things. And if a new useful thing has not appeared on the horizon, should keep your brains polished by just attempting as an experiment, learning something new, trying it out and dirtying your hands. Never let that practice go away from you. Because having done this once, second time you will do it faster, but with something else. And that is why we always say, learning how to learn fast is the important takeaway from our entire education system. It's not exactly what this or that you have learned. Good work, you enjoyed, I suppose.
Yes.
You unfortunately have no exposure to OpenEdX, right?
No, sir.
So there is a comparison that ought to be done in terms of the API richness of Sunbird servers versus OpenEdX. And this is a feedback that the OpenEdX architect has requested when I mentioned to him that over the next year we'll be examining this. So that would be a useful thing. Okay, thank you.